Okay, this sermon is entitled Free Grace Theology in the Book of Hebrews. I'd like to open up with prayer. And then with a few verses, all right, dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners, I ask all this in Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 100 reads, Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Now, according to the unsaved, the book of Hebrews is one of their go-to books for false doctrine. I've heard people say that the book of Hebrews proves that you can lose your salvation. They go into Hebrews chapter 6 and also Hebrews chapter 10, and they take a bunch of verses out of context, when in reality, the book of Hebrews proves eternal security, as well as other facets of free grace theology. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 4. In Hebrews chapter 4, we have the concept of faith alone. We'll start off with verse 1, and it reads, Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. So what we get from this is that the only condition for salvation after a person hears the gospel is faith in Jesus Christ. And what that profits or what that benefits is eternal salvation. But in the book of Hebrews, the term rest is a verisimilitude for salvation. And we see that in the next verse. It reads, For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, As I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. So once again, the only condition for entering into God's rest is to believe the gospel. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 11. We see this concept again, and we also see the concept of imputed righteousness. And this is a central or key element to free grace theology. Hebrews chapter 11, it reads in verse 7, By faith, Noah being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world, and became heir of the righteousness, which is by faith. So once again, we see this concept of faith alone. Now turn back to Hebrews chapter 7, and we see the concept of eternal security. In verse 25, let's back it up to verse 24, and it reads, But this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. Now this is the crux of eternal security. When God saves someone, he doesn't change his mind. Eternal security or salvation is immutable, and it's because of the simple fact that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins. There's nothing anyone can do that can change that. Goes on in verse 25, Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost, that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth, to make intercession for them. So what this means is that we're not just saved, we're saved to the uttermost. How on earth can you lose that type of salvation? And what we also see from this is that Jesus Christ ever lives to make intercession for our sins. So irrespective of how sinful we are, he has paid for all of them, past, present, and future. Now we see this concept again in a couple more places. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 9. In Hebrews chapter 9, it reads in verse 12, Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Now we see several things here. We see, number one, that salvation took place at one time in history. Jesus Christ only died for our sins one time, once for all. Okay, he's obtained eternal redemption, not temporary redemption. It's eternal redemption, and he did it for us. He didn't die on the cross for himself. He died on the cross for our sins, and he gives us eternal life, which is eternal redemption. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 10, and let's take a look at verse 14. We see this concept again. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. And what this tells us is that the reason why we're perfected is not because of our own works, or our own deeds, or our righteousness, or our holiness, or anything like that. It's by the offering that he hath made for us. He has perfected forever them that are sanctified. Sanctified simply means we are saved, set apart by God. Now, let's take a look at some verses that these unsaved devils go to and they try to twist, and they try to make people believe that they can lose their salvation. Now, we've already seen that that's impossible, but let's just go to these verses anyway. Turn back to Hebrews chapter 3. Let's take a look at verse 14, and it reads, "For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end." Now, the Arminian claims that this verse teaches that you can lose your salvation. The Calvinist says you can't lose your salvation, but if you're truly saved, you will hold the beginning of your confidence steadfast unto the end. Well, if you jump back to verse 1 of chapter 3, the Bible is very clear that this is addressing believers. It reads, "Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus." So we know this is talking to believers, and as we've also seen through, you know, these clear scriptures, salvation can't be lost. So verse 14 and also verse 6, they like to use that verse as well, do not prove that you can lose salvation. Verse 14 is actually saying that those who hold fast, steadfast unto the end, these people will have a special privilege in the kingdom of heaven, and it's because they were persecuted for their faith, and it's because they endured to the end. This has nothing to do with salvation. Anyone who is saved already has eternal life. John 3:15 makes that clear, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:36, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. A saved person already has eternal life. They're not trying to get it with their useless and feeble, pathetic, works-based attempts. So the book of Hebrews does not teach salvific loss. It does not teach salvation by works. It does not reject faith alone. So let's take a look at a few more verses and then I'll close. Now, the Bible makes it very clear that we are encouraged to hold fast unto our faith. We are encouraged to, you know, live a holy life and to endure to the end. But it's not for salvation. And we see this in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 23. "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised." So the reason why we should hold fast the confession of our faith is because we are saved and God is a faithful Savior and God does not break his promises. So that's all I have. The book of Hebrews clearly teaches eternal security and clearly teaches free grace theology, and these false prophets are just reading the Bible with the blindfold on. So that's all I have. Let me go ahead and close in prayer. Dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners. I ask all this in Jesus' name, amen.